This is Diane Andrews in Black and White. The issues you don't want to talk about. The arts and entertainment you need to know. And now here's your host, Diane Andrews.
Thank you. I'm Diane Andrews, host of Diane Andrews in Black and White. Thank you for being here with us today, in-stage audience. I appreciate all the cheers. And out-of-stage audience, whether you're on television watching us or whether you're on YouTube, keep those YouTube subscriptions. I appreciate that. We're trying to grow our base. I guess you know what this is about, and you guess I know what this Kelly Green is about. Today is St. Patrick's Day. So for all people of Irish descent, a non-Irish descent, I wish you a happy St. Patrick's and healthy St. Patrick's Day. And I also want to say something that I wrote for my mother. Her birthday is this week. And it says, and she's passed on, a mother's love is a tie that binds, that lasts for more than a lifetime. And it really does. Today, I think we've got a very interesting show for you. I think it can help you with your financial status. We're doing something called Financial Crimes and RFID EMV, which is radio frequency identification, which is the chip now on your credit card. And it's also called EMV, which is Europay MasterCard Visa, which is the newest chips. And Detective Brian Blosch is going to talk about that with us. He's been here with me before. We did identity theft together. His name is Detective Sergeant Brian Blosch. He works in the Financial Crimes Division of East Baton Rouge Parish Sheriff's Department. He started there in 2002. He spent 2 years in the parish prison, and he went on in high-tech crimes. He was deputized by the U.S. Marshal, and he worked with the Department of Defense, and now he's teaching verbal judo. He also teaches identity theft, which is a show we did, and he also teaches forensics, I think, because you're a specialist in forensics also, aren't you?
Yes, ma'am.
On my right, I have a very good friend of mine. I guess everybody always says, is everybody your friend, Diane? Especially they come in from out of town. Most of my friends are out of town. Pamela Hurd, as she wants to be called. I call her Pam. But okay, for the show, it's Pamela Hurd. And she's a former educator from, she's originally from Roanoke, Virginia. She spent her formative years in Baltimore, Maryland, I guess, over formative years. She went to college there at Morgan State for her undergrad and Loyola University for a graduate degree. She is well-versed in counseling and in family and consumer counseling and productions and things like that also. She spent 33 years with the Baltimore public school system, correct?
Correct.
And then she went on down to Broward, Florida, and worked in Fort Lauderdale for 9 years.
Correct.
So her background has a lot to do with education. She was an assistant principal. She worked with the curriculum. She did grant management. She's done all those things. But we were debating something yesterday that she didn't have on her resume. She said, wow, I forgot to put how I worked in entrepreneurship in the schools and how they don't have those curriculums now. So she's also an expert with working with curriculums for entrepreneurship in the high schools. So let's start talking about one reason I asked my friend here. We were speaking several months ago, and she said, wow, I had my check was washed. I said, check washed? What are you talking about? I never heard of it before. And it, what they do is they take a pen, where you've written out your pen, and I'm going to let her explain it to you, but I will say this. Check washing is a $1 billion industry for crooks, not for us, that they steal from the public every year. So let's start. Tell us what happened, Pam, with this check washing.
Well, in December, just before the holiday, I mailed five of my bills. Mm-hmm. I mailed them in an outside post office box. Mm-hmm. And, you know, of course, thinking that everything was, never had any question.
Right.
But on a regular basis, I checked my bank account. And just before I left to go out of town, I checked my bank account, and it was a negative. And I said, that can't be. Mm-hmm. Because I knew that there was a deposit, and I knew that there was money in the bank. So having done so, I looked a little further. I went to that section online, and I pulled up those transactions that had occurred. And I saw transactions that were not transactions that were mine.
Now, were you looking at transactions or the actual check? Could you see the actual check also?
At that point, I pulled up the check. Uh-huh. When I pulled up the check, that check was not the check that I had written.
Mm-hmm.
I had written a check for $25 mm-hmm. to a vendor, and it had then been washed. At that time, I didn't mm-hmm. know what had happened,
mm-hmm.
but I could clearly see that it had been written over.
Mm-hmm.
And
the bank sent it through anyway.
It went through. And of course, it was very disturbing because the check that I had originally written was $25. And the check that had been written after whitewashing
mm-hmm.
was $1,780.
How much did they take from you total for those five checks?
Over $6,000.
And what they did, you mailed it at the post office.
I mailed
you said
it at the
outside
office.
Boxes they have at the post office.
Correct.
So they hit that entire box. They robbed that box, probably.
They robbed that box. Two of those two bills were not used.
Mm-hmm.
They only pulled three.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess they just randomly pull.
Right.
Or however they get to them. They were able to access them and they used them. Well, I was really concerned, and this was about 12:30 at night. So I called the bank. I couldn't get a live person. And as a result, I then contacted the police.
How often do you all get those calls here in Baton Rouge,
well,
detective?
Yeah, check washing was really popular some time ago. When I first started out in financial crimes,
mm-hmm.
check washing was rampant
yeah.
Here in Baton Rouge. They would steal checks from the mail, usually checks that were placed in the mailbox and the flag raised.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, what that's telling the post office is that you have something that needs to be picked up.
Right.
What that's telling the criminals, though, is that you have checks in the mail.
Yes.
And so people would pull the checks out of the mail, and then take those checks and wash them, washing the payee off
yes.
and the amount, and then changing, rewriting it to fit whoever they wanted to cash the check.
The reason I'm holding this is acetone. They can take this household product, for us women, our nail remover product, and put it in a bowl and actually leave the check there for a period of time, 30 minutes, hour and a half, and the ink will come off. Now the only pen, could you pass me that pen down there, that does not allow check washing is the Uniball gel pen, black. That's what I read, and that's what we did. Last night, we took a check that I wrote, and I wrote part of it in non-Uniball. And I don't know how close y'all can zoom into this. And then you can see where I wrote in the Uniball, and it stayed in the acetone. This part is almost faded. If we had let it stay a little longer, it would have. But the black with the Uniball is very vivid with the check. You can see how. So the acetone is what washes the check. But if you use a Uniball black gel pen, it becomes what I read. It becomes a part of the particles in the paper. Now, this check was washed, and the paper feels fine. They will never know any difference in the weight of the paper, right?
Yes. Yeah, precisely. Once they're done with that process and it dries, you can't tell that it's been
right.
washed.
And it only took this maybe a minute or two to dry mm-hmm. when I took it out of the acetone this morning. So I thought that was very interesting. I'd never heard of that, and I think it's a billion-dollar industry still, around $1 billion. Mm-hmm. So it must have been bigger than that back in 2002 when you started.
Yeah. Well, it's gotten, as things spread, back when we were doing it, it was about $800 million
uh-huh.
a year. But, of course, there's
people
new ways
of... one of those figures.
Yeah.
$800 million, a billion, I'll
so
take either one.
It's topped a billion, but it's slowed down, believe
yeah.
it or not. It's slowed down, especially... since a lot of transactions are now electronic.
And I understand, too, they have a security check. You can buy a different paper that will not accept, you can't wash it. Not
yes.
Not
yes.
only just the pen.
One, yeah,
the pen.
Once you put it in the acetone, the words appear like void.
Yeah.
You know, or altered. So, yes, there's, of course, the parchment is much more expensive.
Right.
So you pay more for it.
For those checks. So
yes.
You can buy special checks. But just go out and buy your Uniball gel black pen. And that will prohibit them from being able to wash off your name, the amount, or anything on that check. So we wanted to give you all a little information on that. Let's talk about the credit cards. Anybody
mm-hmm.
got a credit card on them? Mine's over in my purse.
mine
with a chip. Anybody in the audience want to give me a credit card if anybody has one? Nobody has one. Does everyone, if you want to give, I'll give it right back to you. I swear I won't steal the number. Do you have one? You do? Oh, thank you, sir. I'll come get it. No, y'all get it for me? Okay. That's right, I can't go that far. But we'll be talking about that as he gets, everybody knows the new cards have this chip on them now instead of just the strip. Detective, you want? Okay. Thank you. That's my makeup artist, you all. Megan Adams. Okay. All the new cars. Now, this is that the chip over here?
His doesn't have the chip.
You don't have the new chip on it. You still have the magnetic strip.
Yeah.
The new cards have a chip. When they issue you your next card, sir, it will have a little chip on it.
He has one.
You have one? The cameraman didn't want to give me his card. He doesn't trust me. Mm-hmm. Pam, can you reach for it? Just reach over. You know, we're interactive in this show. We bring everybody in. Thank you. You see the difference then? He just has the old magnetic strip, the audience member. The cameraman has the new card, and as they issue, all new cards will have this new chip. Is that correct?
Yes. That's what they're going to.
And so the chip at first was radio frequency identification, RFID.
Yes.
And now it's EMV.
Yes.
So I see these ads all the time on television. And I went out and bought something, even before I was going to do the show. They sell wallets now that block people from being able, because the problem, and let me know if I'm right or wrong, Detective, is that with the RFID before the EMV chip, you could be sitting out in that audience and you could steal that information from this card with it being in my wallet. Is that correct?
Yes. With an RFID chip, the ability to read the chip is more likely the closer you get to the chip. So in actuality, someone could get really close to where your wallet is or where your purse was and have a reader inside of a device like a bag or, you know, something that they're carrying and be able to read that chip through your purse.
Right.
Well,
scared me to death when I saw all of this. I was watching HSN or one of those shows, and I said, oh boy, I got to get this. And they even have the wallet. I said, I don't like the way the wallet looks, but I'll just put this in my, you just put it in your wallet, and it blocks that device,
blocks
that radio frequency device from stealing your credit card information.
It creates a barrier.
So yeah, the barrier between, what is this made of, do you know?
Now, it's probably some sort of metallic. It's probably made of some sort of metal. That stops
it says something about power grid technology on there.
Yeah, and it's basically the same kind of technology that we use in Faraday bags and Faraday boxes for phones in forensics, where you can take the phone and put it inside of the bag and it blocks the signal.
Oh, okay.
So it's basically the same kind of
technology. Is that a radio frequency signal? So anything radio frequency that will, a power grid blocker will block
it'll
that
block
for
the radio.
So people who have the chip cards that are radio frequency, now EMV, which Europe has been using forever, which is Europay, MasterCard, and Visa, have gone together and created even a better card. Now, the reason they went to the card was, everybody remembers when we did identity theft about 15 months ago, and I first started doing my shows, pretty much, Detective Brian Blosch was on there. We did identity theft. But one of the things we talked about was people stealing your identity through credit cards and how they were affecting Office Depot and Lowe's and all of those kind of places. And now with this new RFID, which Europe has had forever, that won't happen to the Lowe's, the Office Depot, or the ABC retail shop, right?
Yes. What happens is the transaction has a unique identifier rather than all of your credit card information.
Hold that thought. We're going to be right back with Diane Andrews in Black and White to help you keep your financial money in your wallet without it being stolen by a chip device. Thank you. Come on back to Diane Andrews in Black and White.
Order your copies now of Diane Andrews' latest books. Third Man Out, a suspenseful mystery by Diane Andrews, and Gumbo for the Heart, 25 stories of faith, hope, and charity, both available now on Amazon.com.
Thanks for coming back to Diane Andrews in Black and White. While we we took our break, I went out to the audience and I wanted to get their opinion and some of their questions on how they can better be prepared for this new world of dealing with chips and cards. We had a question from Monica that said, do banks reimburse the person if this is, happens to them, this identity theft kind of crime?
Yes, the banks do reimburse you, but what the banks are doing now is they are changing their practices a little bit. What they're saying is that if your PIN is used, which is your private number, mm-hmm. if your PIN is used, some banks are not refunding your money because they're saying that PIN should not be known by anyone else but you.
Because now the PIN, I just don't want people to get misunderstanding. It's your personal PIN. It's not the security code on the card.
Yeah, not the security code on the code. Yes, it's
yes.
your PIN.
Okay.
And so that's why they're making the chips, the EMV chip. It's called chip and PIN.
Uh-huh.
Because you use the chip, you put the card in,
right.
and then you enter your PIN. So some of the banks are fighting that, saying that if somebody...
I've got the chip. They've never asked me to put a PIN number in either before.
Yeah, because some of the cards are chip and signature.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mine is still chip and signature. So yeah. Is that EMV or is that still RFID?
It's EMV,
mm-hmm.
but it's chip and signature,
okay.
which the vendors are saying is not as secure as chip and PIN
mm-hmm.
because anybody can forge a signature.
Okay, just like we were talking about before the show, and I gave an analogy with the new EMV cards, every time you have a transaction, it goes straight to the merchant, right? It
yes.
goes to MasterCard, it goes to Visa. It used to go back to like Lowe's or Office Depot and Lowe's. I'm not talking about you, just any company, ABC retailer out there. And
mm-hmm.
then that's what made them more liable when they were losing all the money a couple of years ago and still are when they were being hacked. So now it's gonna go straight from me personally, straight to my MasterCard or my Visa.
Yes.
And also it changes it every time. Like a garage door opener, I have a garage door opener. If somebody happens to have a garage door opener similar to yours, it can open your garage with the same signal, but mine changes every time I open the door, so you can't get another person ever having that same garage door opener code because it changes codes every
yes.
time. A lot of garage door openers do that.
Yes, and this EMV technology makes it harder for them to counterfeit the actual card
mm-hmm.
itself.
And that was one of the questions. Well, Prophet had a question, ways to stop fraud with the banks.
Okay.
I can address
that. You can address that.
Not totally, but I can say as a person,
mm-hmm.
check your bank account on a regular basis. Don't assume that everything that is there is correct.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's an error, immediately make it known.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you don't, then it goes on. You can go back, yes,
mm-hmm.
but it's best that you do so initially.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason that I filed the police report was because I had no one else to speak with personally.
Mm-hmm.
So I filed a police report at night. The police officer contacted me and took a report that I then took to the bank the next day.
But you never heard anything where they caught this syndicate, which I know they never hardly do you, Detective Sergeant?
Well, we actually catch quite a few of them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a lot of them get away because the jurisdiction changes.
Mm-hmm.
In Ms. Pamela's case, they used the items in her jurisdiction.
Mm-hmm.
But in a lot of cases, it happens somewhere where you don't live. You know, these numbers, your information is transferred to someone in another state.
Mm-hmm.
And,
another country even.
Yeah, and even another country.
Yeah.
And so it's hard to track where exactly this person is going to use it next or when it was used.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody really knows who that is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you might have a face or information, you know, where you can show a videotape, but you don't know who the person is and nobody comes forth to say who that person actually is.
Okay, John Calloway, he said he's not running from any law, any person, any woman, anything. I could say his last name. How do they take the money off the chip? How do they get the money off is one of
yeah.
his questions.
Well, what happens is the point of sale machine, when you put the card in it, it creates a key.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and that key is then used in conjunction with your PIN to authenticate the card,
mm-hmm.
and then it finishes the transaction. With just a strip, all you had to do was swipe it, and the information is already on the strip.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why it was so easy to counterfeit those cards.
Yeah.
Whereas with the new cards, it creates this key that can't be counterfeited because it changes every time.
Right, like the garage door opener scenario.
Yes.
One last question we took was from Shauna, and when will the chip cards be out all over, because they've been in Europe for years.
Yeah, they've been in Europe forever. But all of the banks are trying to make this transition now. I believe that the time for that transition has already passed. But you know, it's hard to get all of the banks and all of the smaller institutions to implement everything at one time. Of course, it costs money. They have to get new machines.
Right.
So the new cards are being disseminated, and you know, they're moving towards it, and it's currently in the process of pushing out all of the cards to everyone.
Because there's already been a deadline that we've missed, right? That all cards have to be by a certain date.
Yeah, that all cards have to be, have to be chipped, and that all of the vendors and retailers have to have the machines. That time is actually...
What was that date?
I actually believe it was last year.
I put a red line in Russia like we do, and nothing happens. Right?
I believe it was last year. Okay. I believe the deadline was last year, but they're moving towards it. I mean, they're working hard at it.
Okay, that was about it for the questions. That question though, you gave a way to monitor, but the question was, is there a way to stop it? Which the answer is no.
There's no
way to stop it.
There's really no way to stop it. You really have to monitor.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be proactive, and make sure that your practices are safe.
Like Pamela did.
Yeah, you don't share your PIN with anyone.
Mm-hmm.
You don't give your debit card or credit card to anyone. Make sure to look at your anyone you don't trust. Yeah. But I would say anyone.
You have some people out in the audience won't give it to their husband.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, but you have to deter it, and of course you have to detect it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the monitoring.
Constantly.
And the deterrence is making sure that you're using correct practices. And then if it does happen, then you really have to be proactive in defending it.
Let me ask this, Ken. Let's say your bank usually doesn't give you a new card until this one expired, but they may have the chip cards already. Would it be safer for some people to go call their banks, their Visa, their MasterCard, and say, hey, I want that new chip card. I don't want the strip anymore. Can you do that?
I would imagine you could request it. I would imagine if your bank has them, mm-hmm. And you haven't received one, I would request one. Yeah.
And back to some of this with the check washing, they actually robbed the postal stand, you know, the box outside. Yeah. Happened to be outside the post office, but we have standalone boxes that people drop mail in all the time.
Yes.
So they don't have any cameras on those boxes or anything, mostly.
Yeah, I mean, I've never seen where they had cameras on the boxes, but it's possible.
Obviously not, because they're going to catch them.
Depending upon what time they did it, I don't know how much they'd see.
One of the comments that was made by the police officer when I filed my report, because it was a holiday season, that they're more rampant,
December,
of course,
Christmas time.
And that they have so many ways of doing things, and that there, during that time, and I was later told that there had been a lot of this type of crime
activity going on
across
in the Florida area,
in that area, and it was because it was a holiday, and they were their take on this was that so often with mail, because people use credit cards so frequently and debit cards now, you don't have a lot of checks floating out there.
Mm-hmm.
But they were looking for and be very careful about sending those gift cards. Because gift cards during the holiday, people use a lot of gift cards.
Yes.
And they said that really in the post office, of course, they're mailing them, they're sending them, they're giving them whatever.
Yes.
And it's more difficult, I'm assuming.
Absolutely.
You cannot do anything with that.
Yeah,
unless
you know what the gift card number was.
Yeah.
That you sent to someone, there's no way for them to track where it went after somebody intercepts and uses it.
That would be the easiest way to steal from the gift card. But I guess they decided, okay, we didn't get enough gift cards, we're going to take it from these checks, so let's just drop it in some acetone overnight, and then I can write on it whatever I want to write on it.
Yes.
And you said it was over $6,000.
That was reimbursed within a week's time, which was great. Once the report was filed, because it is insured, the money was put back into a new account.
Yes.
The old account was immediately canceled.
Mm-hmm.
I was issued a new account, and the money was in the bank within 3 days.
So really, you only
back into my account.
Seven days, which was really
fortunately exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Really, what we're going to do? I'm going to take a short break, and we're going to come back for my clothes. Come on back to Diane Andrews in Black and White.
Or Order your copies now of Diane Andrews' latest books, Third Man Out, A Suspenseful Mystery by Diane Andrews, and Gumbo for the Heart, 25 stories of faith, hope, and charity, both available now on Amazon.com.
Thank you for coming back to Diane Andrews in Black and White. In our break, we were discussing some other things that the detective would like to tell you, and then we're going to come in for our close.
You know, some of these checks are accessed because people mail their checks on certain days. Let's say it's a Thursday or a Friday. The check actually makes it to the business that they're mailing it to. But some of these businesses, and some of the businesses here in Baton Rouge in certain areas, have outside mailboxes. Mm-hmm. The mail hits the mailbox on a Saturday, and then the mail sits there Saturday and Sunday until the vendors come in on Monday.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we've had and we've caught people actually walking down the street in those areas, taking the mail out of those mailboxes. And what they're doing is they take those checks out of the mail and they either wash them if they can, or they actually add themselves as a payee on the check and then go somewhere and cash the check.
They type their name on the check as a payee.
Yes.
And they can make it match.
Exactly.
Wow. Okay, let's be aware. This is some great information, so even be aware of the day that you're mailing your check if it's to a business. I ask people this all the time when I do my clothes, if they get tired of seeing me light this white candle. When I was a little girl growing up in Marouge, Louisiana, there was a show that came on, and every Sunday, they lit a white candle and said, if everyone lit just one little candle, what a bright world this would be. And I've tried to live my life that way. I never forgot that. And having a bright candle in your life means you're trying to have a path of goodness for others to follow, I always say, and you're trying to bring good to everybody's life that you can. And that's the one thing I'll tell people. It's not all about money. It's about time, care, loving. So everyone, if they would go out today, and if you see someone crossing the street who's an older person, help them across the street. And that makes you feel good, and that would make their day. So everyone go out and try to make this a day that you're lighting a candle for someone else, which will illuminate your life. Take care. This is Diane Andrews. See you next time. Go join us on YouTube. Bye-bye.
Welcome to Debbie's Bridal, A Formal Affair.
My name is Raven. I work at Debbie's Bridal, and she makes your dreams come true.